Christ, would you pray with me, ask God to bless me? Dear Lord, the Church of God needs you. We need you. Our hearts are heavy and they are broken. Bless that you would bind them up and you would restore us. Many times we feel hopeless. But looking to you, let us remember our reason for hope. That you came, that you love us, that you are with us, and you will take us to be by your side in heaven. Lord, restore that hope to us this day. We're all together. That there is hope found in you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, it is the most wonderful time of the year. Christmas season is back, and happy Christmas, Merry Christmas. I'm not going to say happy holiday in your church, Merry Christmas. And I would believe that if we would compare notes about what your Christmas experience is like, that our notes would be very similar to one another, that our Christmases would be very similar. And to prove this point, I want to do a Christmas poll, how similar our households are and how similar we are. I wanted to know, Christmas poll, happy in your household, wanted to know that how many children, if there's children now or if when you were a child, you would search the house for the presents that mom had bought you. Raise your hand if you search the house for the presents that your parents bought you, okay? Don't be afraid, go on. All right. Now we're going to get a little older. I want to see how many of you actually found the presents that your parents got you. That's a pretty good percentage. Good job. Now here we're going to, this is for the rebels, and don't worry, you're in the same environment, you're not going to jump and get up. How many of you actually played with the presents that your mom got you before Christmas? No, all right, we're all good. See, there we go. Another gold star for our effort. We're all good. Some rebels might be hanging out, I don't know. The best story I ever heard about this was told by my mom. She knew a woman who, she saw a gift wrapped by her husband under the tree. She opened it before Christmas, and she found an article of clothing that she didn't particularly like. And so what she did is she actually returned that article of clothing to the store, got something else, put it back in the wrapping paper, back in the box, under the tree. And you can imagine what the husband went, huh? But everyone knows that that's not what you're supposed to do, right? You're supposed to have patience. You're supposed to wait until Christmas to open those presents. But the thing is, it's so hard to wait. It's so hard, especially for children now, for Christmas to come so you can see what presents are wrapped under the tree. There's so much anticipation. I bring that up because we're going to focus on a different group of anticipators, not children opening presents. Today, the Word of God, we find a group of people, the Israelites, who are waiting not to open presents, but for God to fulfill His promise. A promise that He sent long ago to send a Savior. They are waiting and waiting and waiting, and some have stopped waiting. They've lost hope. But we're going to focus on a few who kept waiting, even though it seemed hopeless. Kept waiting for His promise. And so, yes, today we begin a new series, Simple Christmas. The premise is to cut away all the excess and just focus on Jesus, that baby who came for us. And today we'll see why there is reason to have hope in hopeless circumstances. And if you've ever felt like God wasn't listening, this is a message for you. If you've ever had a circumstance that you don't know why it hasn't changed, if you've prayed about it, if you've ever wondered the payoff of being a believer or going to church because you give and you serve and it doesn't seem to work to anything, if you've ever experienced a period of spiritual dryness, reason why we too have hope in all circumstances. So let's get in. Today, those who held up hope in hopeless circumstances, the people we meet are Zechariah and Elizabeth. I invite you to meet them with me as we read the first two verses of our lesson, top of page 7. Here we go. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron, and both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commandments and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive. They were both very old. We're going to pause there and put the worship folders down. We're going to consider those words. Before we dive into Zechariah and Elizabeth, I want to ask, Do you know a group of people that hold out hope in hopeless circumstances? We live in Chicago, Chicago area is filled with these people holding on to hope in hopeless circumstances. I don't mean to pick on anyone today, but you know where I'm going. Cubs fans. Okay, don't mean to pick on anyone, but it's been a century, right? A century they waited for the whole thing to come. And the curse of the Billy Goat Church seems real with no remedy. And now, even with Theo Epstein at the helm, everyone knows the security of our village. And it's a main table line. And yet, in dear old Chicago line, we find these questions. Those who are still willing to go, still willing to put on the gear, still willing to cheer in the face of a hopeless circumstance. And I said that because it's one thing to wait a century for something to come. It's another thing to wait for 20 centuries for something to come. Can you imagine waiting 20 centuries? If you can imagine that, then you can imagine where Zechariah and Elizabeth are sitting. Because it had been 20 centuries, over 2,000 years, that God promised to do something to a man named Abraham. He promised to send a Savior 2,000 years ago, and still it hadn't come. It had been 10 centuries since the time of David. Since the time God promised to David that there would be this king who would reign on eternal throne. And the last bit we hear about God's activity of his promised Savior is recorded in the book of Malachi. The prophet Malachi says this about the Savior who was to come. He said, "See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me." That's John the Baptist. "Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to this temple, the messenger of the covenant, whom you desire. He will come, says the Lord Almighty." Last prophecy about God's activity and this promised Savior. But you know what that was here? 4 centuries ago, 4,000 BC was the last that they heard a word from God. And it seemed like in 400 years, God was silent. For if you know anything about the nation of Israel, they had gone past the heyday of King David and Solomon. In 722, half of them were wiped out. The northern kingdom, captured by the Assyrians, wiped out. 586, the Babylonians came in. The southern kingdom, Judah, they were captive and took off, though a remnant did remain. They had lost power. They had lost influence. They were not prestigious in the kingdoms around them. Spiraling down. Now fast forward to the time of Zechariah lives. In 63 BC, something happens that is quite significant. In 63 BC, there is a Roman leader, a military ruler by the name of Pompey. In 63 BC, he leads a successful campaign against Jerusalem. He sieges Jerusalem, he takes it over. In 63 BC, this Pompey would walk into the temple of God, which was forbidden because he was a Gentile. And then Pompey, history tells us, has the audacity to not only walk in the temple, but he walked into the Holy of Holies. If you know anything about the Old Testament, this is something only a high priest could do, only when it was announced at a specific time during the year. For in the Holy of Holies, that was where God's presence was signified. There you would have the Ark of the Covenant. And God, he would kill those who would come into the Holy of Holies unannounced. Everyone in the Old Testament knew that. And yet Pompey, here's an artist's rendition of it, walks into the temple, goes into the Holy of Holies, and you know what happens? Nothing. Zechariah was probably annoyed when this happens. Because he's old, right? His dad was not home as a priest and told him this story. The awful thing that Pompey did. Comes to what people were saying. God was here, he's left us. God is no longer there. He doesn't care. He's not going to act. He's not going to fulfill. Zechariah and Elizabeth were living in a period of hopelessness. Not only did they have a history of hopelessness, but Zechariah and Elizabeth had personal reasons why they could be hopeless. Our account told us that they were good people, that they served God. In fact, if you look back at this, it says that you are righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands blamelessly. Now, it doesn't mean they were perfect. There's no one perfect besides Jesus. But it does mean that they were faithful Christians, faithful believers. And as a byproduct of faith, they're also filled with good deeds. That everyone knows these were good people. That they believed in the Lord, that they did good things. Kind of reminds me today of like a Tim Tebow. Don't know what you think about the man, but everyone knows he's a good man. Everyone knows he's a pretty good guy, whether you like the Broncos or him or not. Just know him being a believer. Even Tebow in his brain. And so that's that where I listen. They're known throughout their community for being these good people. They believe in the Lord and they're righteous. And you think God blessed them then. In every way, that God would bring this blessing upon them, and yet, the Bible also tells us that they were childless. They were barren. Perhaps there are some here, some who know a heartache involved with this, the dream of children doesn't. But they were living in a time where there was extra added social skill. They were living in a culture where they interpreted someone who was barren to be cursed by God, which is a wrong thing. And if you were a woman in that culture, you know, this is a long time ago, I don't think you're offended, but a woman was looked down upon for not being able to have children. That's exactly what I did. Holding out hope in the midst of difficult circumstances. Friends that made you love, time for some introspection. You ever been in circumstances that have only spiraled down? And you've asked, you've wondered, if God was there, you could have done something. If God cared, you would respond. If God cared, you would have to not let it go. You ever been in this position where you do what the Lord commands, and you're not perfect, and I'm not perfect, but you do what God commands to the best of your ability, and you ask for His blessing, and you look for what He's promised?
Whatever they're
signify, they kind of seem like gentle creatures. Kind of like your grandparents. You just want to grab a cup of coffee, cozy up with them, and have a discussion. If you remember, if you can see John Travolta, he looks kind of nice. Michael, the back in the 90s. Hearing a chicken, I'd like to talk to this guy, right? He's not scary. But you read the Bible, and it's a completely different picture. When people see angels, they are terrified. They are pleading for their lives. They are down face on the floor, asking not to be hurt. It's a terrifying thing. That's what Zechariah had. I think part of the reason is because as sinful creatures, imperfect creatures, we get scared in front of holy creatures. Sinfulness in front of holiness, and that's what makes us scared. We don't get this hurt. Zechariah is scared. But here's something. It's all right. I'm here to. And then the angel says something else. It's one of the takeaways for you. Right before the angel says this, he says, your prayer has been heard. And I think if you're Zechariah, this is awesome news. Just to have confirmation that all the prayers that he said concerning a baby, they were listened to. In fact, I think for you and I as Christians, if we could just get confirmation about our prayers, that'd be awesome, right? Like if every time we prayed, God would send his little angel, a maybe not so scary one, let's just like have half-sized angels so we're not scared, but just to show up and say, we heard you. Or maybe not just an angel, maybe it was just a voice, where every time we prayed, he'd say, yep, I got it. I know. And I think what the Bible is saying, whether angel or not, voice or not, is this, that God does, in fact, hear you. He knows. You see, he's not so far off. He knows you intimately. He knows your name, the hairs on your head. He knows exactly what is going on in your life. Every struggle, every emotion, what it feels like when no one understands, he does. Not only was Zechariah heard, but his dream was fulfilled. Angel goes on to say, you will have a son. Let's now learn more about the son. We pick it up in verse 14. He will be a great joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. He has never taken wine other than to drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go out before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready the people prepared for the Lord. So yes, this is John the Baptist. John, who is a great man. John, Jesus even said of John that there was no other man greater born of the Lord, that he was basically greatest to live. John who prepared the way. John who pointed to Jesus and said, that is the Savior, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. At this point, Zechariah should have just been quiet. Zechariah should have just done a head nod and said, all right, thank you. But he's foolish. Again, he's not perfect. He's a believer, but he's not perfect. Let's look now at his foolish response, verse 18. Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? I am an old man and my wife is well along in years. Alright, so he's pretty blunt with himself. I'm old. My wife is well along in years. And that's euphemism for saying she's old too. And she passed the point of bearing children. How is this going to happen? And it's kind of ridiculous because he's already in the midst of a miracle. The angel of the Lord is talking to him. If God can do that, he can sure do the other, right? That's what the angel says. Verse 19. The angel said to him, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you, tell you this good news. And now to fulfill it, verse 20. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you do not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed. So he will have a shot. But what is perhaps maybe the biggest takeaway in all of this? Is that it will happen when? Grief? John's work and greater than John's birth is the one who will come after him. This signified that the promised Savior is coming, that Jesus would soon be born, and Jesus would certainly walk upon this earth, and Jesus, he would come, and this too at God's appointed time. And at the appointed time, we know the rest of the story. This man would give his life for you and I, that at the proper time, our redemption would be sealed, and the whole world would be saved. That's our God. Gives hope to us. So, dear friends, are we foolish? Are we foolish to hold out hope? Is our God just a crutch? I think if this story is true, we are not. We have true reason to hope. And yet we need to remember that though God hears our prayers, he will act in his time, at the proper time, which is rarely early. It's never late, but it's always just out of time. And in the meantime, may God find us being like Zechariah and Elizabeth. May God find us continuing to work out the good fruits of faith between known to do, to serve here. And let us take Paul's encouragement in doing good works. He says this. He says, let's not become weary in doing good. No matter how long you've been doing this, a week, a day, 7 years, 70 years, don't become weary. Because you know what? At the proper time, the appointed time, God's time, you will reap a harvest if you don't give up. And maybe that harvest is here. Maybe it's in heaven. But a harvest is there for you and I to not give up. What I'm going to end on what is maybe the most relevant to our story, what is maybe the greatest application. Zechariah and Elizabeth have waited 20 centuries for the coming of the Lord. And you and I stand today in the same shoes as Zechariah and Elizabeth. But we have waited 20 centuries, not for his first coming, but for his second. And we live in an age where people have given up, haven't they? Where there are doubters saying the same things that were said at Zechariah and Elizabeth's time. He's not there. He's not listening. If he was listening and if he did care, that wouldn't happen. If he was listening and he did care, you wouldn't let that happen in your life or in that country or that disaster. You're foolish. You're holding out hope for nothing. I know this story is something different. That as God fulfilled the hopes of Zechariah and all the people that came the first time, so he will come a second time. And so let us remember that with joy. And as we celebrate the Christmas season and focus on this first decree, let us long for the greater and the completion of his plan. Amen. God has transcended all understanding. May they guard your hearts and your minds in faith in Christ Jesus. God has the opportunity to encourage one another with a confession of common faith. We'll confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed, top of the page. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated.